For those who know how to read, I have painted my autobiography.
July 16th, 1938. My dear Sabortez, write to me at Hotel Vast Horizon, Mougin Village. I have company. Dormar, Nush, and Paul Eluard are here. Mougin is an hour from Cannes, a little town up in the mountains from which I can go by bus to bathe whenever I please.
On the eve of the war, in 1939, he and Dora Maar were spending their vacation here. They walked along the jetty very frequently, watching the fishermen, and especially at night, when the fishermen put out these big lamps to attract the fish, and in fact painted there one of the most beautiful big pictures, the night fishing at Antibes. Here on the right, you can see Dora Maar herself. She's holding her bicycle and licking a double ice cream cone. Now look at these spear fishermen. This fellow is leaning down into the water. It's very dark. He can't see very well. It's as if the parts of his face were really reaching down into the water, the eye coming out of its socket. His neck is so stretched out that it looks the length of a horse's neck. This kind of distortion is not done in the interest of abstract painting, of the kind of thing that led Picasso into cubism, but to express in some way, through an image of the human body, what feeling is like. Now, Picasso painted this night fishing picture just on the eve of the war in August of 1939, and in the spring, he was in the town of Royan with his companion Dora Maar. The Germans were occupying the town of Royan. There was a curfew. For Dora Maar, the anxieties were even greater because, as she was Jewish, she had a tremendous fear of what would happen to her once caught by the Nazis. Now, Picasso paints this picture of her in which she's in a kind of compressed space, as if the walls of the room were closing in on her, and her anxieties, her sense of being drawn in different directions, of not knowing what to do, are expressed in the way in which the face seems almost to turn left and right at the same time. And the feeling of being reduced to a kind of almost animal state is expressed in the way in which the hands seem no longer to be human hands, but almost like the hoofs of horses. When we think of the exquisitely lyrical pictures Picasso made of ladies doing their hair early in his career, and then we look at this painful image of Dora Maar fixing her hair, we have another kind of sense of the felt image of the self.
During the occupation, Picasso remained in Paris, and this was a great comfort for those of us who remained too.
People who had not lived in the occupied France doesn't understand such things, but it was important to know that Picasso has not fled away. In this time, you know, the life of Picasso was in danger. So many intellectuals, writers, painters that had been killed by the Nazis. Max Jacob was arrested as a Jew, and Picasso could do nothing. Picasso had always said that he had joined the Communist Party to join the young fighters of the resistance.
Paris was liberated, but I was besieged. It's very strange. In Paris, I never draw fauns, centaurs, or mythical heroes like these. They always seem to live in these parts.
At the end of the war, in Paris, he had met Françoise Gillot, who was a painter. He fell in love with her.
Like the idea, do you think, of having children at that point of his life?
I think it was very important for him. Actually, he's the one who insisted very much that my mother had children. I mean, she wasn't really wanting to have children. He sort of pushed her into that. And I suppose he was very proud, I think. There are lots of pictures of us and of Maya and of Polo. They are not, I don't know whether the portraits are always this, you know, the most important things, but just the fact that they was a new child would bring a new, you know, impulse in his work.
The Galois was a very, very tiny house. This is why he had the other place, the Furnace, which he used as a studio. Furnace was an old perfume factory, and he got it, you know, for nothing, and used it because it had enormous space. Time he did a lot of ceramic, but that took place at the actual pottery factory.
Yeah. Ah là, ça va aller, il doit y en avoir trois. Hein.
When he arrived in Valoris after the liberation, he was tempted to try ceramics.
S'approprier cette technique. Picasso avait le sens de la matière.
Picasso had a feeling for materials.
On mangeait sur une nappe en
in a restaurant, on a paper cloth, while we were talking, he was drawing.
Il avait besoin de s'occuper les mains.
He had this urge to keep his hands busy. He had this tactile feel for things.
Donc, que ce soit le papier, que ce soit la céramique, que ce soit il avait besoin.
He had this need to touch, to tear, to create something.
De créer quelque chose, c'était dans sa nature.
It was his nature. As if he thirsted to understand the new materials he encountered.
Les éléments nouveaux qu'il rencontrait, n'est-ce pas?
I've been making plates. They're good. You can eat on them.
He knew where everything was, and of course that's why he didn't want anybody to touch anything, because it was a mess from the outside, but he knew, you know, he had arranged that mess.
On the way to his studio, there was a dump, and he would pick up little things there, and he would recover toys of mine, and he would, that I had smashed up a little bit, or quite a lot, actually, the baboon, who is the little child, was made, the head of it was made with two of my cars, and a vase, and half of a blade of a car suspension and little bits and pieces of pottery and then a little plaster too, so that it all fell in together and, you know, various things like that.
As a kid, how did you feel about his taking your cars?
Well, I thought, you know, I deserve my own scrap pile, you know, and I had kept my destroyed cars, you know, for a purpose too.
I took a bicycle seat and a handlebar. I put one on top of the other, and I made a bull's head.
Picasso's sculpture was even more revolutionary than his painting, because there are no precedents for construction sculpture. Nobody had done anything like this, and he didn't owe it to a predecessor or to a colleague or anything else. Not that Picasso didn't carve or didn't model. He did both of those things. But the really radical sculpture, the construction sculpture, was made with materials that had never before been associated with sculpture, pieces of tin, string, glass, bits and pieces of upholstery and so forth. Now these works were compacted, glued, attached, soldered, screwed together and so forth, and I think that this opened up a whole region of sculpture, that sculpture after Picasso is more different than that which followed the work of any other sculptor in the history of art.
What did your father expect of the woman he lived with?
My father was such a controversial person that he expected everything, and he would expect one thing at one moment and then another thing, demand another thing and another that had nothing to do. You know, he would like change his mind about 20 times in an hour. So that it was sort of hard, I think, for the woman living next to him to sort of follow, you know, all his moods and fancies. So he wasn't demanding one thing, he was demanding, you know, a million things.
Picasso was no saint. He was Machiavellian with women. with dealers. He liked to see them jealous and in competition with each other. He had a rather difficult character. It was not easy to live with him. No great artist is easy to live with. Maybe that is why afterwards Françoise left him and took the children with her.
I love art as the only end of my life.
Our first summer with Picasso, I had a little studio on the second floor. Picasso was downstairs. One day I heard a voice. It was Picasso's.
Est-ce que je peux entrer?
May I come in?
Et j'ai aperçu cet homme qui arrivait avec ses yeux, n'est-ce pas très intense.
I saw this man with his intense eyes.
Avant d'entrer dans la
pièce, he said before entering,
je viens, moi, en voleur.
You know, I come like a thief. Painters steal what is best from each other. So take all you want from me, and I'll take anything I like from you. And he stepped into the studio.
One of the women of Algiers resembles Picasso's wife, Jacqueline, in a startling way. You have the impression that Jacqueline was Delacroix's model. She was seated among the women of Algiers, and she really was a personage of Delacroix and of Picasso. She still is.
When I paint, all the painters that are or ever were are behind me, watching. Delacroix was watching when I did Femme d'Alger. I wonder what Delacroix would say if he saw these. I think he'd understand. I'd say to him, you were thinking of Rubens, and you were painting Delacroix. I was thinking of you, and I was painting something else.
We would go in the streets, and people would gather around us and ask for autograph and all that. So we were conscious of him being so famous.
Famous? Of course I'm famous. Lola Brigida. What does it all mean? It was at the Bateau Lavoie that I was famous. When young painters from every country brought me what they were doing and asked for my advice, when I never had a sou, there I was famous. I was a painter, not a freak. Of course, an artist needs success, not only in order to live, but so that he can realize his work. Still, of all, hunger, misery, incomprehension by the public, fame is by far the worst. It's the castigation by God of the artist.
After La Californie, he got Notre-Dame-de-Ville, which is the last house he had in South of France. And he was very excited to be in a new place. Actually, he would always get rid of his house once they were filled with things. That's sort of what happened for all his life. So once a house got filled, then, well, you had to move to another one.
There are so few people who understand. And later, when everyone admires you, there are still the same few who understand, just as few as before. There's a time in life, after you've worked very hard, when forms come to you just like that. When pictures come to you just like that, you don't have to bother about them at all. Everything comes just like that. Death, too. Everything can be explained scientifically today. You can go to the moon or walk under the sea, but painting remains painting because it eludes such investigation. It remains there like a question. And it alone gives the answer.